getting a sick feeling, I'm nauseous. Part of me wishes you kept the shit still in the closet. I'm white, but this is giving me mixed feelings like logic. I remember kids stealing your big...
I know we're talking about a touchy topic, but come on, bro.
Although today you may weep because you're weakened, and everything seems so bleak and hopeless, the light that you're seeking, it begins to seep in. That's the only thing keeping you from leaping off the mother freaking deep in. They call me a freak because I like to spit on these seats while I eat them. Man, get deep.
It's like, is he pointing at Wayne, or is he pointing back? Well, I mean, he has his finger pointed in Wayne's direction.
Let me know who y'all think won this bitch in the comments.
You get the spitter when I'm in the vicinity, motherfucker, you better duck, and you finna be dead the minute you run into me. 100% of you is a 50% of me. I'm about to fucking finish you, bitch. I'm available. You wanna battle, I'm available, I'm blowing.
A monster. Fucking with the common denominator, cause I'ma be the mediator for the even if I hit it up against a veteran. I'm an opponent feeling like he wanted, I'm on it, I wanna do it, I'ma kill him, I innovative for rhythm. And an imminent amount of energy, wouldn't be out of my level, a level over the other with the butter and the vocal epitome. Got a gutter with the dialect of venomous in him and never stutter.
So I'm sitting here trying to decide what to post for Marshall Monday, and I'm thinking, hey, Paul Rosenberg dropped that little cute podcast with Eminem and shit. You know what I'm saying? It was dope. It was cool. We did that shit on the Patreon, but we got this shit right here. This is like the interview, in my humble opinion. It like gives you the dopest grasp on all this shit that took place with everybody, man. So y'all enjoy.
Have we met?
It's nice to meet you, Eminem.
It's nice to meet you, Paul.
Wait. So are they like best friends?
I met Marshall through Proof. I used to go up to the hip hop shop on the weekends, and Proof used to host these battles every week. Proof said, "Yo, I want you to stick around after the battle. I want you to meet Eminem. I want you to hear him rap." Everybody knew I was studying to try to be a music lawyer, and I was, you know, going to be Proof's lawyer, and Dilla and everybody else that I was friends with from Detroit. So for him to want me to meet another guy who he thought was really talented was really unselfish. But I did stick around, and he came in, and I sort of remember it very vividly. He was wearing this all-white sweatsuit, and he was selling his Infinite cassette.
Fire. Did you buy a copy?
I did, from you. I gave you $6.
Thanks, man.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
I supported you from very early on. I bought the cassette from him, and Proof had him rap.
Now I'm trying to repent from it, but when I hear the beat, I'm tempted to make another attempt at it. I'm infinite.
It wasn't like, oh my God, this guy's gonna be the next biggest rapper on the planet.
Well, fuck off, then.
It was very good.
That?
I enjoyed it. I liked the Infinite album, and I stayed in touch with him after, but he needed to bake a little bit more.
I wasn't like, oh my God, this guy's gonna be the coolest manager ever. Oh my God, like...
He needed to bake a little bit more. It's just, that damn album was... It was for a black audience. That's what it sounded like. It sounded like the hood. It sounded like urban America, man. And that's not the sound or the look they had set for him. His reach wouldn't have gone that far. He had to turn into Slim Shady and all that to become that monster, bro. I get it. I wonder if he had that Slim Shady-ass shit up here while he, like, during that Infinite time, though. You know what I mean? Because I know when Eminem, I seen that fucking documentary with Dre, and Eminem came in there with that Slim Shady verse already written and showed Dre that. Like, that's not something they cooked up. Eminem already had that. So I'm wondering if he had that during Infinite time, too, but... Did he want his career during Infinite time to go that way? Did he want that to be his sound?
Guy's gonna be the coolest manager ever. Oh my God, like, at that time on some real shit, I'm sure I was just excited to have anybody even listen to me.
I'd be like, you know, Mac Miller right now.
And take me seriously, especially Paul being based in New York or whatever. Even the excitement of that, oh my God, he's got connections in New York, he could, you know, anything was a lead, anything was a ray of hope, you know. Back then it was like everybody's just trying to make connections, and Paul was a really good one.
Paul's priority is M. Like, he has one goal, is to make sure Marshall is okay. It's very rare that you find those type of relationships. Everybody else has somebody that'll easily transition from that artist to another and still be in the business. And I don't see that happening at any point.
Well, I first heard Eminem's music at Jimmy Iovine's house. He just happened to have gotten Eminem's tape maybe a couple of days before. And he actually got it from an intern that used to work at Interscope. He popped it in and I heard it and I thought it was incredible. At this time, I had no idea he was a white guy. I didn't find that out until a few days later.
Because he sound black
and
on that album.
I was just like, what the fuck is this? I really need to meet this guy. The first thing that we did was Hi, My Name Is.
Yeah.
I had already prepared a sample that I thought he would sound great on. Immediately after I put it on, he just went, Hi, my name yep. is.
What? My name is. My name is.
His name is Sadie.
Hi, my name is.
I was hanging out at Fat Beats with my friend Max Glazer, and all of a sudden I hear a record come on that I've never heard with Eminem's voice. I walk over to the DJ booth, and Max is standing with this really tall dude with a goatee. I introduce myself and I say, hey, what's this record? And the tall guy turns and says, hey man, I'm Paul. I'm actually Eminem's lawyer. This is a record M just did with Dr. Dre. And the record was My Name Is.
99% of my life I was lied to. I just found out my mom does more dope than I do. I told her I'd grow up to be a famous rapper. Make a record about
the contrast between him and Infinite right now is crazy, bro. I'm sitting here still thinking about that shit. Like how Infinite came out in 97. When did SSLP come out? 96. 99, so 3 years. Oh, okay. All right.
Dope than I do. I told her I'd grow up to be a famous rapper. Make a record about doing drugs and name it after.
When I heard he was going to start his own label, I thought it was an amazing idea. I was excited to see what they were going to be able to do with it.
We definitely wanted to have a name that people could identify with Eminem. So Shady Records just made a lot of sense. Both of us, I think, have always been drawn to things that get a strong reaction out of people, you know, whether good or bad. The character's sort of designed to be the alter ego that can take all the blame for that.
All right, calm down, relax, and start breathing.
Fuck that shit, you just caught this bitch cheating. While you at work, she's with some dude trying to get off. Fuck, slit in her throat, cut this bitch's head off.
Back when we used to do open mics and shit like that, it was you got one shot to get a reaction out of this crowd. And to be able to even have an opportunity for someone to want to hand you the mic again next week, that was a survival mode for me. Our whole brand was built off speaking our mind and let's sign MCs and try to get rappers on the label that can spit, but also perk ears up, say things that maybe the next rapper might not say.
That's one of the things that drew us to Interscope too. We knew that what he was doing was going to be met with some controversy.
Mm-hmm.
The place that had Dre and Snoop and Tupac and Marilyn Manson, it was a good match.
Put my tape back on the rack. Go run and tell your friends my city's whack. I just don't give a fuck. But see me on the street and duck. Cause you gon' get stuck, stoned, and snuck. Cause I just don't give a fuck.
To put it in the most simple sense, Marshall makes music. I figure out how to get it out to the world and sell it. That's
marketing.
Kind of the basis of the relationship. So me being in the studio is not a common thing. I only come in here when he asks me to come in here, check something out. I learned a long time ago that I belong out there. He belongs in here.
M's whole career is propelled principally by his skill and his phenomenal musicianship, but it also is complemented at every turn by Paul's ability to market what M makes. In the first video, it's black and white. M has dark hair. It's very sort of gothic Americana. And by the time they get to the My Name Is video, all the colors are bright. He has blonde hair. Everything is much more dialed. Paul and M were able to totally refine their vision for how they were going to market Slim Shady as an idea.
Hey, what's going on? This is Paul Rosenberg, your faithful attorney at law. Listen, I listened to the rough copy of your album, and you know, I just got to be honest with you. Can you tone it down a little bit? Because there's only so much I can explain. Give me a call.
Marketing, bro. That's dope ass marketing.
Skits were sort of designed, in my mind at least, to show that
Paul's like my dad.
To show that there's somebody who knows that some of this is a little bit fucked up.
Em, what's going on? It's Paul. Dre gave me a copy of the new album, and I just... Fuck it.
We just wanted to show that there's an adult in the room.
But he does, you do that. He does do that.
That's cool.
Still to this
fuck.
Day sometimes. Not to try to censor me or anything like that, but no. When I'm, you know, going a little too far out on the fucking ledge, you know, sometimes he's talked me off it a couple of times.
Hi, everybody. This is my friend Dr. Dre. He's okay. Just send money. Lots of it. Or he won't be. Say bye to the people, Dre.
Couple.
Meaning two.
Paul's not the kind of label head who's going to try and censor you. You know, the second that you start trying to change people, more might change than you want.
Bars. I get reacting to this shit. That's a dope-ass fucking interview, man.
We owe a lot to Dre for having the ability to make the label. He helped us a lot at the beginning. He produced stuff for D12, he produced stuff for Obi.
Yeah.
And let us take Eminem songs and put them on an 8 Mile soundtrack that was on Shady, and he didn't have to do all that. To have the opportunity that Marshall had early on working with Dre to sit in the room with him creating records like the 2001 album, he was smart enough to say, you know, we have to soak some of this up and learn and, you know, not just be in the other room drinking or smoking or whatever. So good job, man.
Mm-hmm. I was in the other room taking pills and drooling on myself, but...
But paying attention nonetheless.
But paying attention nonetheless.
Eminem was one of the few artists that really paid attention to the actual production that goes into making a record. Y'all know me, still the same OG, but I've been low-key. Hey, he wanted to know how the mixes were done. He wanted to know what all those buttons did. He would look over my shoulder constantly and ask me, what are you doing when you do this?
Watching Dre's process, the production side was like, holy shit, no wonder it sounds so big and full. Obviously because of his mixing capabilities, but he's using live instruments. I didn't know people do that.
If you have live instruments, you have all these separated tracks, there's a chance for you to really put your signature on the record.
How he would build the Chronic 2001, it was like he's making a whole picture. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's not just this song and this song and let's put this song. It was almost like a movie from beginning to end.
It's no reason why the listener that paid their money for your record should fast forward through songs. It should be an experience.
Being with the Bass Brothers, I was like, wow, this is cool, because now I already know what kind of beat I want, and I go back again and watch Dre and be like, oh shit, so he's humming this bass line and telling this person to play this, and then he's got this, he's like, yo, what, okay, bring this up, like, he's like a conductor, or what do you call it?
Composer. Yeah, conductor. Composer.
Composer. Conductor. Yeah, exactly. Watching that, I'm like, let me try that.
Dre pretty much taught him how to do beats.
M wrote a song for me called Forgot About Dre. And he had those lyrics already done. It was kind of a weird thing for me, having to like make the music fit the words. You know what I mean? This is like one of the few times that this has happened in my career. And I was in. We just went to work.
Damn, that's crazy. That's dope as fuck. That's crazy as hell, though.
Me personally, I'll never be able to touch Dre on the production end. But the fact of him just, even the little tidbits that I did get to see, it was an honor to be able to even do that. I never had set out in rap to ever become a producer. But once I learned how to do it, the whole process got fun.
Him, like, now knowing how to produce. I wasn't a producer. I was making beats. And I, you know, I learned the difference. And that motivated me to want to be a producer at that point. We were learning how to recognize the difference between the song you put on a mixtape and a song that's be on an album.
It's rare to get those opportunities to be able to study from the masters. And we had that ability. You know, hopefully he's a fan of what we've done. Hope so.
We're a family, and there's nothing that I wouldn't do for Eminem. I have to give him as much props as he gives me.
Nowadays, everybody want to talk, that they got something to say, but nothing comes out when they move their lips to the bunch of gibberish and motherfuckers act that they forgot about Dre.
That's hard, man.
It was always a dream of mine to have a record label. To have the opportunity to do it with, you know, somebody as talented as him was kind of a no-brainer.
I had a pact with D12 that the first one who makes it goes back and gets the rest of us.
Cool, calm, just like my mom, with a couple of Valium inside a palm. It's Mr. Mischief with a trick up his sleeve. Pull up on you like Christopher Reeves.
After the success of the first album, yeah, I saw it as more of an opportunity to be able to get my group signed. And Paul saw it as, you know, an opportunity to be able to have our own label.
Devil's Night was a uniquely shady album that these underground rappers from Detroit were able to go double platinum without having a song on the radio is really pretty incredible when you think about it.
Because of Eminem, though. It's just because Eminem was on the damn album, bro. It's like, come on, dog. He had the Midas touch. Anything he touched was going to go fucking crazy.
Song on the radio is really pretty incredible when you think about it.
When we found out about our deal, it just felt like we had a shot. Not having to worry about paying for studio time and shit like that, it was like crazy. Like, I just remember feeling like we actually made it.
M, he's so humble that sometimes he doesn't realize his capabilities. Putting his own label together and putting that out that way, I feel like it was a thing that Paul put in front of him, like, yo, this is what we should do. And you can do this. And he slam dunked it.
I'm not going to say names, but some people didn't want him to have a record label at Interscope. Cool. Because...
No, say names.
They
Hold on, cut that off for a second.
They thought, we'll talk about it later. They thought that he would get distracted. Right? So this guy who's, he's doing so well and he's making his own records, we're doing so good with these, why do we want to distract him away from that? And they didn't really know what he was capable of yet, and certainly didn't know what I was capable of yet. So I guess I understand where they were coming from, but when people tell us not to do things, we want to do them more. Facts. Usually. Especially him. So.
Hence the adult in the room and the child.
Def Jam started out
Paul doing all the talking.
In my dorm room. We started about a year ago.
Def Jam, I think, was a huge inspiration. Rick and Russell in particular. They sort of laid the blueprint for what hip-hop could become as a record label. Their goal was much broader than ours. They wanted to create this, you know, sort of huge company, but we always wanted to remain boutique.
Call it a boutique label, but it's King Kong's label. Like, the biggest rap artist, period. You understand what I'm saying? Like, worldwide, anywhere.
The way he puts together his lyrics.
But it's King Kong's label. Like, it's the biggest rap artist, period. You understand what I'm saying? Like, worldwide, anywhere.
The way he puts together his lyrics, the writing process, the way he records, how particular he is about the way he sounds. Lose Yourself is one of my favorite songs. I mean, this motherfucker won an Oscar, man. I mean, what can you say about that?
And the winner is
this motherfucker been popping for a long time, bro. Killing it, dog. This puts everything in just a dope-ass snapshot, man. Fuck. That's hard, bro. Seeing all the covers of the magazines he was on and shit.
Music, the moment you own it, you better never let it go. Only get one shot, do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime, you better.
You can do anything you set your mind to, man.
It was incredible to watch. It was one of the first times in music that I seen somebody at the helm of something so powerful. It just appears that he could do no wrong. M just had the Midas touch.
Yup.
I got shot. Both my legs was broken. Got hit 3 times on this leg, so I had a pin from my hip to the top of my knee. This leg was broken on the other side, the bottom down. My hands broke, shot in the face. I was very bad.
the stuff that happened with 50, nobody really knew if he was gonna ever be able to even make music again.
Right.
And I think there was some kind of call between me and Paul where he was like, yo, 50's back.
That's hard. That's hard, bro. That's a dope ass interview, bro, for real.
He's back.
I'm not that nigga the in the video. I'm not a trick, I don't love the hoes. And niggas know I be on the low. And I get my dough and I twist my dro.
50 and Marshall at the time had the same lawyer, Theo Settlemyer, who was also one of the first guys that gave me a shot at doing some music law full time before I decided to do management full time. Theo was representing 50, and he was getting music funneled through Shaw, and they were giving me pieces here and there. Well, he was filming 8 Mile at the time and very focused on getting the movie done, working on the soundtrack, also finishing parts of the Eminem show all at the same time. So once he got done with that and got a chance to focus on other stuff is when we could bring 50 into the fold.
When I got the phone call that M was interested in the project and he wanted to meet, it was like completely non-traditional. It was like Friday night he's calling me, so I gotta fly to Los Angeles that Saturday. I almost didn't make it. I got stopped in the airport because I had my vest on. Because I wouldn't go nowhere without the vest or my pistol at the time. So they stopped me with the vest and told me it was a back brace I needed for my back. When I met M, it was the first week his second album had been out. And he sold like 1.7 million records. I had a deal on the table at Universal. 1.3 million they offered me for my album, solo album, and then for G-Unit solo album, and I didn't take the deal. And Yayo and them was looking at me like, how much? Like, you're not gonna take it. I didn't even know how to explain it to them that we would just be in the ocean. Like, we'd just be another thing on Universal Music Group. And I'm saying, I'm not doing that deal. I'm doing a deal with Eminem.
50 did this. It's almost like we found this diamond or something. So it was about taking what was already there and us just having the platform to just be able to say, here, everybody, hear it all at once.
I don't know what you heard about me. Put up this chain, get a dollar.
Hey, bro, why am I just getting chills, dog? Why am I just getting chills, bro? What? What? I don't know why the fuck I got chills. I just got chills though. That was this interview is tough.
I don't know what you heard about me.
One of the hardest albums ever, Gibberish Dot Trine, dog. Top five. There's not an album better than Gibberish Dot Trine, bro, from beginning to end, dog.
Everybody, hear it all at once.
Fucking fire.
I don't know what you heard about me. Put up this chain, get a dollar out of me. No Cadillac, no perms you can't see. Then I'm a motherfucking B.I.M.B.
I was only in the studio with 50 probably 7 days for my entire portion of the album. He came in and was just writing his ass off. He was like, put up another one. Wrote it, put up another one. Did his thing, left, and then I took it from there.
I spent more time with him than with Dre when we first met at that point. And he was so excited about it. He was like, yo, this is it. This is next, the next big thing. I had so much other stuff going on in my life that it was like, You like the shit like that?
Yeah.
And he's like, what? You stupid? This is it. This is what's gonna happen next.
You say you a gangster, but you never pop nothing. You say you a wankster, and you need to stop running. You ain't a friend of mine. You ain't no kin of mine. What makes you think that I'm gonna run up on you with it now?
Get Rich or Die Trying was a classic.
Fire.
Number one, because it was a great album.
Fire.
First and foremost. But number two, because it came at the perfect time in hip hop. We needed an underdog. Who was a raw lyricist, who was real, who was what they rapped about. We needed that, you know, and 50 provided that.
People were absolutely rabid
for
them. The record came out, they had to push it up to release it on a Friday because the bootleggers had gotten it. So it came out on a short week and sold over 800,000 units, and then it sold 800,000 again in the following week.
We were in the right place at the right time. We had a great opportunity for him with a great label. And our relationship with Dre, bringing Dre into the fold was crucial from a musical standpoint and just sort of this audience exchange where we could get Eminem fans and Dr. Dre fans and just open it up to both.
We didn't think it was going to get any bigger than that. And for somebody else to go diamond, it's like, all right, y'all can say whatever y'all want. We we know what we're doing over here.
It's your birthday. We gonna party like it's your
50 was popping. 50 was popping, dog, bro. Wasn't nobody touching 50, bro. But that's, I'm biased too. That was like right in my era, like my adolescent years, and I was in, bro. 50 was my guy, bro. 50 was my guy, dog.
Birthday, we gon' sip a card and like it's your birthday. And you know we don't go home, it's at your birthday.
The release of 50 Cent's album was met with universal acclaim critically, and it was also the highest selling album of the next several years. Obitrice comes out.
This is my favorite song to sing along when the DJ goes it on. And if I leave here tonight and I fall asleep and wake up, hopefully she got some tea.
Obi was definitely a good addition. For him being so raw, they were able to take that and turn it into something big, and I just thought it was brilliant.
Obi did numbers like that?
Obi was literally an unknown from Detroit when he signed in 2002, and he put out an incredible straight-up rap album in the summer of 2003, and he sold 2 million copies of it without a radio single. There's not any label in the history of music that has had...
Damn, it's like that?
There's not any label in the history of music that has had 24 months like that.
We literally ran rap for a little bit.
It's a fact.
If it wasn't for Proof, there wouldn't have been any of that. He was the person that, without trying, was able to bring everybody together.
Guys like that just go around every hood and show so much love and are cool with so many people in so many different areas that they so highly regarded just all over the place. You know what I mean? And Proof was one of those kind of people. He was just a special guy.
As the music came along and we was able to grow into a factor into the world and people that could sell records, then M was able to guide those songs. Like, and it was his brilliance behind it, but like the whole idea was Proof. Proof was the glue. We lost the glue to the label. And nobody expected that.
I still haven't really came up with the right words to verbalize how I felt about that, or how I still feel about it.
When Proof died, that really dealt a huge emotional blow to the entire label, and obviously to Eminem personally more than anyone. That was a challenging, tough time for Shady.
I know Paul was just trying to make sure that things kept running. And I think M was trying to, you know, heal from that, man. Like, so, you know, it looked like it was over.
Shady Records experienced a historic run. Then in 2006, for the first time in really ever, things started to not connect for them.
There's been times where a certain song doesn't work, a certain project doesn't work, where we're left scratching our heads like, why did this not work? We think it's crazy.
Jamaican girl, make a true player break. Say it ain't so, your truth is fake.
Good God, Dick, do a little slide. Bend down, cut your toes, and just glide up the center of the dance floor. Like TP for my bunghole, and it's cool if you let one go.
We're not perfect. Sometimes the timing might not be right. Maybe we didn't choose the right song. Maybe the artist didn't write the right song. I don't know.
You got to kind of take that all into consideration and figure out, like, okay, if that didn't work, how come? And let's try to fix it then either the next go around or with the next artist. We've never signed an artist that we didn't fully believe in.
This is the intermission where I go change, then I do some more drugs, then I come back out. But the crowd don't know it. The crowd don't know I do drugs, so don't tell them.
Mm.
Obviously, Marshall had a time where he wasn't functioning at his highest level, right?
What?
So when Marshall got sober and started recording again, he had to find his way to what he wanted to do as an artist first.
I'ma be what I set out to be, without a doubt, undoubtedly. And all those who look down on me, I'm tearing down your balcony.
And once he got that footing and we put out Relapse and then Recovery, we had a conversation where, like, We have this label still. We need to focus on this.
Yeah, we them slaughterhouse rock stars. The bitch is black. We signing every titty out. We going to attack.
Me having a relationship with Royce 5'9", being friends since... fuck, long time.
Yeah.
Reconnecting with Royce, I guess, helped open my ears up to Slaughterhouse. I knew who everybody was already, but the fact of them all coming together was very impactful to me because it was like, these are four guys that are solo artists coming together to make this like super group. These are the guys that perk my ears up and my interest. This is who I want to hear.
Slaughterhouse pisses me off. Slaughterhouse pisses me off, bro. It's like... the Monstars of fucking hip hop together, and it didn't work out because the motherfuckers is prima donnas and shit, dog. How you fuck that up? And Eminem and Yella, bro. Like, that shit frustrates me so much, bro.
Rhyme, I want to know what they're going to say next.
Being with Shady, the thing that I try to focus on is making better music than I made last time. Is it a better body of work? Is it more listenable? Is it classic?
Lyrically, individually, they wanted the strongest rappers ever.
If there's anything that unifies the artists that we've signed throughout the label, I think it's just raw talent as an MC.
Everybody that they signed was a lyricist. Everybody. Every single last person.
I'm do or die dope, and you can make the sticker sitting on the door of that Phantom, your suicide note.
Wordplay, syllables, writing, punchlines, ability to get somebody's attention, we start with that, right?
Yeah, we start from the technical aspect. If they get that part, you have wiggle room. So it's that, it's delivery, and what the person is about. And they always gotta have a cool vibe because you gotta be able to work together, you know what I'm saying? So that's kind of what the three things probably that we base it off of first, and then we just go from there.
Meth lab in the back, and the crack smoke peels through the streets like an early morning fog.
Marshall.
Yella, Eminem is my guy. The GOAT of this rap shit, bro. But, Yella is just different, dog. Because he's so underrated, bro. And there's no one more talented than Yella Wolf, bro. Fuck. Hey, he's so fucking dope, bro. So fucking dope. And Eminem had all these 50, Slaughterhouse, Yellow Wolf. Come on, bruh. Come on, man.
Meth lab in the back, and the crack smoke peels through the streets like an early morning fog.
Marshall was in the studio with Jim Johnson, and he was just playing Marshall different music that he liked. And he was like, yo, have you heard this guy, Yellow Wolf?
I had heard a few songs, but I think one of the things that really sold it for me was Jim Johnson showing me his video.
Went to the Chevy and pulled out a machete, and the gun is heavy and tall as the pigeon wheelow. Think he's playing? You better listen what he's saying, punk. Don't make me go pop the trunk.
When I seen the video, then I got to see the whole vision. I had heard a lot of white rappers, but there was something about him that just stood out.
Yeah, and his perspective's really unique too, in his story and where he comes from.
So it was like, shit, let's do it.
I'm beginning to feel like a rap god. All my people from the front to the back nod. Now who thinks their arms are long enough to slap box?
Where do you see Shady Records going in the next 15 years?
If we're still doing music.
I'm not going to be doing music.
Yeah, he's out the game. He's
retired.
Yeah, he's retired. I'm just tired.
It ain't over till I say so. Ain't up when I say it. Throw me to the ones that close the gate up. I'm afraid of what'll happen to them. When the thought of being thrown into an alligator pit, I salivated it. Wait, it's up.
I feel like I'm lucky, man, because I'm a part of a company that they don't treat the artists like artists. They treat the artists like family. I've been signed to many labels, so I know exactly when it's just business. Being a member of Shady Records means everything to me.
Every single person that was there wanted you to be as successful as possible and would do it whatever they had to do to help you facilitate you being able to do it. They provided a platform for me to be 50 Cent.
Mm.
Every place else was afraid prior to them actually taking the shot.
To me, Shady right now as a label is just as effective as it was then. It's still building artists. We're not just building songs. And that's what I like about it. And I think people can appreciate being able to connect with the people that they listen to, personally and musically.
It's just so exciting to me to watch somebody that I've worked with go on and do great things and give these opportunities to other new up-and-coming artists. Eminem is a fucking genius, man. Him and Paul Rosenberg make a great team. Whatever they decide to do, I know it's going to be big, it's going to be amazing, and it will work.
M is my Dre. It took for Dre to be there, for M to do what he did, and if I didn't have M, I would have never did what I did.
When you look at the product that Shady made, they always made very, very sophisticated, thoughtful, complex rap music. If M can help the right person tap into not only the sort of lyrical dexterity that people know him for, but also the emotional depth that really has been the underpinning of all of his success.
Yup. I should snip that shit and put it in this little fucking Eminem is the GOAT marathon that I'm doing right now, bro. That he hit the nail on the head, bro. That was a dope-ass summary.
Not only the sort of lyrical dexterity that people know him for, but also the emotional depth that really has been the underpinning of all of his success.
That's a fact.
There's nothing that they can't achieve.
Within the next 15 years, we will try to keep shit going and try to sign new exciting acts, hopefully discover the next whatever. I don't know.
The next Eminem. Hopefully
now you're talking. Yo, my man.
Hopefully there's no next Eminem. I couldn't handle a next Eminem. There can never be another you, buddy. Something that terrible the world could never endure again. Thank you. Thank you for 15 years of ruining my life.
No problem.
Appreciate it.
So I collapse, I'm spilling these raps long as you feel them. To the day that I drop, you'll never say that I'm not killing them.
What a dope-ass interview, man. I thought I was going to have to do that shit in two videos. I've been sitting here for fucking 40 minutes recording this shit, bro. It was a dope-ass interview. It's not even an interview. It's just a dope-ass collection of interviews talking about Shady Records and Eminem and Paul's relationship. Hey, they did a good job. Complex Magazine, Complex, whoever the fuck did a good job with this shit, bro. Like, Eminem didn't even talk that much. It was everybody else talking about Eminem and how it was back then. And the whole 50 shit, that was tough. That was tough, bro. Eminem ain't goated in this bitch. All that shit matters. When it comes to reach, without no Eminem, none of that shit goes down. None of that shit goes down. 50. Shit, Eminem's fucking Slaughterhouse, Yellow Wolf. Come on, bruh. Come on, bruh. Fire. Dope. Thank y'all for that one. I enjoyed that.